This week on the Squatters Lounge podcast, Dave and the Reverend Jeff take a look at what do Bigfoot eat during the winter months. And oddly enough, it's exactly the same as the summer months. They eat whatever they freaking want to. But what's available? What do other animals eat? We'll look at this and more. And we're not talking about peanut butter and jammy sandwiches, folks. But first, we've got huge news from Muppet Gate 2014 and an earth-shattering announcement from the folks at the Squatters Lounge podcast. So we'll send it straight to our host, the Reverend Jeff Kelly.
Woo! Welcome, everybody, to the Squatters Lounge podcast. Season 2, episode 49. Good God, almost 50 episodes this year, brother. We missed like 2 weeks. How the hell did we manage that? Well, because we made up some other ones when we skipped them before. As usual, with me is the greatest man in Squatcher's Lounge podcast announcer's history, and my buddy and brother, Mr. Father David Batdorf. How you doing, buddy?
Having a fantastic evening. Just got into the chair down here, just barely in here. And you know what I love most about being a dad? Is, you know, you try to take yourself seriously sometimes, and you come onto this podcast, you got to be serious face. Now, I was blowing bubbles 5 minutes ago, okay?
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, I'm literally sitting here doing the podcast in my pajama bottom. So, you know, that's kind of the way we swing around here at the Squatcher's Lounge podcast. It is that time of year. Well, since it is that time of year and we're actually trying to get a little more organized, let's go ahead and get at it.
And now for the Squatcher's Lounge News, bringing you the most up-to-date topics from across the interwebs week after week after week. The Squatcher's Lounge Podcast. Let's get newsy.
Yeah, so, you know, up in the news this week, there really isn't a whole lot, but the first thing that came out today that was just like, blah, Dr. Sykes' team made a huge error in their DNA report, and now his book is useless. Yeah, that's apparently what it seems to be. Their super secret hybrid of the brown and polar bear doesn't seem to add up, does it, there, Mr. Batdorf?
No, I actually I didn't read this article. I caught it off one of the Facebook's friends. I read it was a BBC article that our friend Jay Cooney from the Crypto Zoo. I read the BBC version, and basically what happened is somebody took these interesting yet inconclusive findings from a TV documentary, and they challenged it. So they said, okay, well, let's redo the sample. Let's really run this. Let's do all the blasts. Let's do a scientific study. And it turns out that it was probably a Himalayan black bear. Brown bear, excuse me.
No. They're saying it's just a regular old polar bear. Ursus maritimus. It's regular old plain old white polar bear. No mystical brown bear, no mystical black bear. That's the whole suck thing of this whole thing.
The article that you got, the one that I got was from the BBC and from the source study that they were doing, and it actually said that it was not polar bear. There was no polar bear at all, except for the fact that polar bears and brown bears were related at some point. Because polar bears aren't native to the Himalayas, which is why that was interesting. The Himalayan brown bear, however, is native to the Himalayas, which is, you know, there are links, and there, you know, are probably, you know, gene flows that can be misconstrued, and I'm sure that Brian Sykes didn't do a full scientific study for this TV show, right? But, you know, basically what they're saying is that it was not what it was claimed to be on the TV show.
Right. Oh, surprise, surprise. Television has misled us. Jesus Christ, David, Batdorf, can't believe what the Bigfoot show tells us. Who can we believe? Well, you can believe us here at the Squatcher's Lounge podcast, because we told you there wasn't anything special about this. You know, and it seems, and we're going to come up tonight, because we do actually have the DNA hair results from what Dr. Meldrum was talking about on Coast to Coast AM last week, where he wouldn't release it. We actually have that coming up here shortly, but it's also done documentary style. You remember the call went out? Now, let me go ahead and clear that off for a minute. The call went out for Bigfoot hair. Dr. Meldrum says, oh, I'm going to do a hair study. So go ahead and send me all your really good Bigfoot hair, because it's just me. I'm going to do this. I'm going to control this hair study. Well, turns out, again, as we heard on Coast to Coast last week, that it ended up being documentary based, documentary funded by some production company again. So here again, for the second time this year, all of our really good viable evidence was dropped in the lap of some production company who only wants to feed you crap, just like they fed you on the Yeti show, where it was just, we don't know, let's just make good TV.
That's the goal when you take documentary money. It's not going to be...
it's not science!
Fully funded study, and they're going to take all the sound bites that they can about, you know, oh, here's this interesting thing, yada, yada, yada. Did Dr. Sykes make it seem as though it was something that it wasn't, or was the results misconstrued? There's so many ways that you can go with this, but they're going to take the most dramatic and interesting way, which relic polar bear, which, I mean, you know, if you go back and watch that documentary, I'm sure that if you
talk, I just watched it today, by the way, all three parts of it.
Yeah, yeah, the possibility, or you know, the traits of, or, you know, plausible deniability, yada yada yada, whatever. But that kind of same game where once you get hooked up with that television company, they're going to, even if they have to take things out of context, they're going to make it seem as though you said something grander than you actually
right, said. But let's take this back into perspective for just a moment. He said in his own words that these were the findings. He wrote a book on it. He wrote a paper on it. He didn't just make a good TV show about it. He then went further on down the scientific line to go ahead and produce materials to his colleagues as though this is the truth, until all of a sudden this article comes out while they're now admitting, well, yeah, it looks like we've made some mistakes. Maybe that's the reason for the renaming of his book.
Could be, is that he knew that there was another study coming out, and, you know, to save you some embarrassment, because we checked your, you know, your hypothesis, checked your findings, and didn't come up with the same thing as, you know, well, we got the guy who was responsible for the first study on links between autism and vaccines, saying that, oh yeah, that study was debunked years ago. I, you know, put that together as a correlative piece, and it just didn't stand up.
Right.
Okay.
But yeah, so, that's what gets baited and put that, on. And...
Yeah. So the media and the production companies and things carry that information forward, but they don't follow it up with, oh, well, and now we have this. Oh, well, there's another study that says, well, just one minute now. That happens in science all the time. That's how science controls itself, the checks and the balances.
Yeah, but it usually doesn't happen like 6 months after the results.
Oh, no, it can happen. I mean, it can happen years after, depending
on... We're lucky in this case.
Data. Yeah, depending on the complexity of the data. But once the claims were made and the paper published, or even the paper, you know, like behind closed doors, and the paper hasn't even come out yet, and it's like, hey, I got this really weird thing, you should check this out, and then, you know, hands off the rest of the sample because they're interested, and then some, you know, that 6 months later that study comes out because it was more complex than a TV documentary is going to do a scientific study. I'm going to do an 8-year study on the morphology and genetic material of this hair sample. No, they're not going
to. Right, on the $5,000 the production crew is going to give you to do the DNA samplings.
They're going
to
blast it, and they're going to postulate like we do all the time, and they're going to print it and put it on film. Done!
Right, there you go. So, you know, don't believe everything that you're seeing on television, and even, you know, when you've seen it outside of television, don't believe that either. You know, look deeper. The story is out there. Well, the next thing I saw up in the news, let's go ahead and move on from Dr. Sykes for a little bit here, thesciencedaily.com. I kind of like this website because they've got some decent articles. I believe it was Adam Davies that I saw post this. It could have been Cliff Brackman. God only knows. They all post up good stuff. Linguistic methods uncover sophisticated meanings in monkey dialects. Basically, when monkeys are talking, it actually means something. The little chitter and the little chatter and the way that they start a noise and the way that they end the noise can actually convey a lot of information amongst the species themselves.
Yeah, I didn't have a lot of time to read through this, and I didn't have time to check the source data, because this is one of those articles where I would be interested in checking out the source data, and I still am going to. But basically, the gist I got from a quick scan was that they're saying that and the way that they know this for certain is because they took the same species and in geographically different areas, there were different prefixes and suffixes to the same warning calls, like, you know, hey, tiger, you know, is suffix A and prefix A, suffix B. And then over here, it's prefix C, suffix D. It's different, but it means the same thing, same level of danger, same animal. So, different areas, same species, but they're using different calls to mean the same thing. And that actually brings up interesting, dialect, and something we know exists in the animal kingdom, but this puts it a little bit closer, like on that cusp, like, well, do you put that into a language now? Because they're actually expressing a level of danger and an actual creature, not just pointing and going, ooh, for everything. They're saying, ooh for tiger and ah for leopard, whatever that means. It's not a complex language, but where does that lie on the
it's definitely communication. It's definitely advanced communication, but in the same type of thing, in one of the articles like this tends to not really look into is the fact that songbirds will do the same thing. If you listen to songbirds, they have different tweets for different dangers. One could be a danger from above, one could be a danger from below, and I'm sure it's most likely going to be like a genetic thing between a family group more so than it would be across the species at that level, but still, they still talk to each other. They still communicate in advanced communication skills the same way that, these monkeys are doing.
Exactly, and the way that language perpetuates itself in, let's say, our culture is a cultural way versus this geographical way. Within a family troop, you grow up within a troop using these sounds. But the interesting thing is that not all primates, basically all primates, either the male or the female of the species, has to leave that troop and join up with others to mate. Right.
That's important.
So that's important, but geographically is what we're talking about now. So if all the monkeys in,
the north part of town speak one language,
bottom of the of the north side of the ridge, and then are using this vocalization, and on the south side of the ridge they're using this vocalization. I mean, that's significant in the fact that that complex communication, bordering upon a language, but not quite there. Is separated by geographical features, becomes different and evolves differently. It's very interesting, and that's a great, great study, and I want to read more about this.
Well, there you go. Everybody can look more into that at sciencedaily.com, guys. Hey, DW Darkwing Lee posted up a link the other day. The MABRC forums are back up online. That's a good resource. These guys got a bad duck with the whole Daisy in the box last year, and they fought their way back, and they're doing their thing. And, now they're not caring what people are thinking. They're just out organizing their events, and they're going out squatching, and they're trying to get their evidence. And that's what I tell people all the time. I don't give a damn what you people think about me hanging out with Justice Meehan trying to get a Bigfoot or trying to get video of it or trying to help him do whatever the hell he's trying to do. When we have the answer and you don't, well, tough shit. But the MABRC forums are back, and there's a lot of really good information up there. So if you're not a member, you can go out there and check them out. If you are a member, you can log in and check everything around again. Have you ever been a member here there, David?
I have not been. Down on the bottom here, I'm actually reading that you do not have to be an MABRC organizational member to join the MABRC forums. So if you're just interested,
yeah, it's open to the public. You can
just interested in lurking, if you will. Could be
it's a little safer than the Bigfoot forums are these days too, man. I'd still stay away from that damn place.
That's a really, really dangerous spot to go. Maybe when we do our quote unquote year in review, we might have to go in there for some deep, dark insight.
Alright, well, the last left thing in the newsy stuff tonight is, of course, Dyer released his hoodie squatch. This is supposedly a picture of his whatever the hell it is. Not sure. This is supposedly what's in the tarp wrapped up. I say give the man a helmet and let's move on. Did you get a chance to see these pictures, David?
I did. And my favorite comment about this in the Squatcher's Lounge was the fact that it does share one very, very Matt Moneymaker-esque characteristic, which is the hair parted down the middle, coming down the sides. The haircut is very, very nice. I can't see anything about this photograph that looks like a biological creature whatsoever. anything. I was looking for where's the good point of this so I can like latch onto it and like and we can talk about that as some sort of piece of like, oh, well, this is what's wrong with this. I know it looks good, but this is what's wrong with it. And I don't see anything.
Yeah, Rick, put your helmet back on. Stop smacking your head up against the wall and you'll be okay, man. Find a job. Get out of the Bigfoot world. I'm not really sure what's going on with you, buddy, but we're just not going to mess with any more of that crap tonight. But we do have a really cool thing coming up for you right about now. David and I have been working on this, and it is time, my friend.
And now, the latest from Muppet Gate 2014. We attempt to bring you the latest from the phenomena straight down to the do-do-do-do-do phenomena.
That's right, folks. Muppet Gate. I don't know what else to call it. It just continues. Now, this week, we've got an update here in Muppet Gate. Bigfoot believer Todd Standing says, oh, God, I've got DNA. I got DNA results. Oh, shit, they're human. Yeah, apparently not all of Todd Standing's DNA results were stolen, and he had a hair sample sent out for DNA testing that came back to be 100% human, no deviations to it or nothing. But Todd says, damn it, that can't be right. What are you thinking there, buddy?
I would say that can't be right because we know the difference between even our closest cousins, the Neanderthal and the Denisovan folks over there and us genetically differ in enough ways to say that they're different. So the Sasquatch, with the morphological differences, there's going to have to be enough genetic variation to create those differences. So cannot be 100% anatomically modern human on either side, especially not on one side only.
Todd swears this is a perfect sample. Uncontaminated, he said. It cannot be mine, and it cannot be another human being's. And in fact, in all the knowledge that I have and everybody I've spoken to, I can't even be a known primate. Well, damn, Todd, where did you find this one particular hair after the rest of those DNA evidence pieces had gotten stolen? I'm not really sure what to think here, but part of Muppet Gate, you know, is the spread of the infectious disease that Muppet Gate really is amongst the rest of the morons out there. And I'm not talking about you people watching the show. I'm talking about people like Melba Ketchum, who then latches onto it and says, I'm vindicated. Holy Christ. Todd Standing has Bigfoot human DNA. I win. Yeah, no, Melba, you still don't win, honey. There's nothing that says it's different than a human. Therefore, it's the same species. It can't be a new species if it's the same species, can it, David?
It... By the tests that they have run, it cannot. When there is a 100% match, you can't. Anyway, it can't be something different.
I'm right there with you. I am, and it's just horrible. It really, really is. Now we've gotten an exclusive video that's probably actually the origins of the Sylvanic Bigfoot family that Todd's actually been following and taking video of. And David and I decided tonight was going to be the night that we were going to break this footage for you, and here it is. I mean, that's just the most incredible Bigfoot footage I've ever seen in my life. What do you know? It's even named the Sylvanian families. Hey, let's take a big tally of the $900,000 that Todd's looking to win here. $1,000, so he's up like $80 more than he was last week during the podcast. Yay us! That's all I can say on that. We knew he wasn't going to get $900,000. We knew he wasn't going to get $100,000. We knew he wasn't going to get $10,000, and he knew it too, because all he wants to do is hold this footage hostage and make somebody pay his way. That's what he's looking for. At least that's my opinion. David, what are you thinking, buddy?
That's kind of been where what I've been hinting at, and what I haven't said completely out loud. The Kickstarter was not fundable. You're drumming up like curiosity is going to get the better of somebody at some point with enough money to pay for this footage. And now, whether it's a lot of people paying a healthy sum, or if it's one person paying a ridiculous sum, that's what this is going towards. I can I can I would guarantee it with I'm not a betting man, and I'm not going to put anything on the line right here on air. But this is where this is going. I'm just going to call it right now. Like we've called so many things, and it turns out, well, okay, it turns out to be that way. This is going to be a money grab at the end, and either somebody's going to fund a documentary coming out that's we're all going to get to see, and it won't be that great, or calling it right now, or this is just going to go for $20 to $40 pitch to as many people as he can get it out to, because curiosity is going to get the better of us and somebody's going to buy it.
Yeah, you know, well, that's the whole thing. There's nothing new to it. It's all the same old Sylvanic footage. It's the Bigfoot running up the hill. It's the it's Winky and Blinky. There's a little bit new footage of the devil, and supposedly some footage of the recreation of Meldrum sighting that they don't have any footage of. I mean, it's nothing new. That's the whole thing that really kind of irks me about it, is the fact that, you know, we're still being held hostage and we still haven't seen it. So even after Dr. Meldrum went on Coast to Coast and said nice things about Standing and called him his colleague. Now, I'm sorry, but a PhD professor at Idaho State University to call Todd Standing a colleague goes really, really far out there for me and kind of, you know, raises a lot of eyebrows. But let's talk about that for a moment, because Dr. Jeff Meldrum here now, next year, is going to be doing the Idaho State University Bigfoot, the Relic Hominid Projects class. You can actually go and listen to a class and take a class with Dr. Jeff that's going to bring up some of the Bigfoot-type theories of evolution into his class. Now, is this what he's really been posturing for the last two decades? I don't know. David?
That's hard to tell. I mean, it would probably be interesting for an entertainment point of view, or tying it into like the
we all know you take bullshit classes in college like basket weaving. I'm sure that's what this is intended to be. It can't be. I mean, it's got to be like the life and Church of the Jedi, right?
Well, when every answer is Gigantopithecus. No, I'm joking. It could be interesting to tie all the new information together and all the unknowns that brings into the unknown hominology. But Idaho State University now is doing this probably for the same reason that Todd Standing started that Kickstarter, is to bring attention to the fact that, hey, look, we got this Bigfooter guy on the staff. It's pretty interesting. It's kind of fun.
Maybe we can get Bigfooter kids to come to our college. You know, they have money.
No, they don't.
Exactly. But that's probably not what they're looking at.
Yeah, but I mean, it's something fun. It's something easy. It's not. Okay, here's the thing. It's not easy. Like, you go through that, if you're trying to teach that class, it's basically calling out all the empty spots in the human fossil record based on all the new information. And if you actually taught that in class, it'd be really complex and convoluted.
Well, he's got 12 people already signed up and seats for 30.
You know, if I had the funds, and I would be really interested in going into that class, but I probably don't have the prereqs to get in there.
Yeah, you might have to take a class or two to get there.
Exactly. But that in and of itself is fine. The RHI, the Relic Hominid Inquiry paper, where he's publishing some of these things, that's fine. I am taking, you know, my interest in this and Dr. Meldrum's specialty, it kind of cuts me a little bit deep. I mean, we're talking about somebody who is kind of the idol of my interest in this topic. You know, like the go-to guy. You know, there's the wildlife people like Myanzinski and Pindernagel that have phenomenal backgrounds and are interested in this topic, and that's great. You know, in the scientific area, but this guy is like the physical anthropologist. I love bones, and I love human bones, and I love really old human bones. And for him to say that Todd Standing is his colleague is kind of like deflating to the entire topic.
Yeah.
Like, you know, you keep that, you know, I keep that thread of hope that someday we're going to find something good and there's going to be good people in here. And that takes that one little thread that I'm dangling by and phrase it out even more. Just, this is ridiculous.
Yeah, it just it frays even more at what little bit of decent strings that we did have going for us in the first place. Well, to continue out and roll out the rest of Muppet Gate tonight, as we teased at the beginning of the show, now that we're halfway through, I know how to do this stuff. It's called radio. At least that's according to somebody. What's radio? Anyhow, I do have the results from the documentary that Dr. Meldrum was talking about on Coast to Coast last week that he said he wanted to let air before he would say anything about. Well, it aired last night in the UK. If our UK viewers watched it, wonderful for you. I'm only going to play a 2.5-minute cut just for fair use purposes so that David and I can talk about it afterwards. And, well, take a listen. This is going to be exactly what you're going to want to hear out of this entire program.
Patterson Gimlin, 25:17. The path of the squatching man is beset on all sides by the inequities of the hoaxers and the tyranny of dishonest blogs.
Oh, sorry, I hit the wrong button. Well, that's our buddy Chris over at the 40 and Slip with his new Patterson Gimlin piece, and it is fantastic. You should guys go check that out. Sorry, here's that audio we were looking for.
But there is one more piece of missing evidence that could still prove skeptics entirely wrong. In August 2013, retired Army medic Jason Miller saw what he is convinced was a Bigfoot. The next day, he returned to the exact same spot and found a collection of hair samples. These samples, along with several more found by other eyewitnesses, were analyzed by Dr. Jeff Meldrum before being sent to a specialized lab for DNA testing.
If the results are positive, the implications are profound. They will be huge, earth-shaking, I think, in many ways, because we'll have recognized the existence of a species more closely related to the human family than any other that has previously been discovered or studied.
At Todd Dissertel's laboratory at New York University, the DNA results from the hair samples are now complete.
So we finally have the results. This is the sequence from Jason Miller's hair sample that he sent to Dr. Jeff Meldrum. Here we see the individual DNA bases, the actual A's, C's, G's, and T's that make up the DNA sequence. I'm going to run it against the international database to see what it might or might not match. There's my result. The closest match is Otocoileus virginiensis. That's the American white-tailed deer.
Well, shit. Hang on, there's more.
The sample that Jason Miller collected the day after his sighting turned out to be an ordinary deer hair. But what about the others Dr. Meldrum had obtained?
One of the other samples sent to me by Dr. Meldrum turned out to be a cow. And several of the samples were actually, unfortunately, contaminated with human DNA.
DNA analysis of the hair samples has failed to provide any kind of positive proof for the existence of Bigfoot.
Well, there you have it, people. I mean, that literally is, as we called it, if there was going to be any kind of announcement, if there's going to be any kind of actual finding from one of these documentaries, you can guarantee that you would have seen Meldrum, Dissotel, the producer of this friggin' documentary, and 12 other people sitting at some press conference table going, well, we can't really, because we gotta wait to be able to present it, but trust me, we have something wonderful coming, and it's groundbreaking. And we didn't hear any of that. And matter of fact, Meldrum was even afraid to say anything about it the other night. And, you know, what's the point if you're going to hold back results from your hair study until the documentary comes out? Then it wasn't really your hair study, now was it? What's your thoughts, David?
You got to find funding from somewhere, but the results of the hair study, you know, you don't have to dance around the issue. You could just say, I can't talk about it until the documentary comes out, you know, or I can't talk about it, you know, due to you know, the media involvement or something like
right. That. And that wasn't how he played it. He played it as though that there was some kind of interesting result and that we should all kind of hold our breath on by until we got that out. And well, I can't really talk about it until the show comes out. You know, and that was kind of the way it was baited in. And if Dr. Meldrum's out to make good TV, wonderful, let's make good TV. But let's not play in the public as though it's a scientific study when it's a documentary study. That's the kind of thing that I'm looking at.
I love, you know, Todd Disitel, but again, he's used a lot in these, you know, crypto genetic studies, and I can't imagine that they're doing, you know, the full on, like full blast, full cleansing, full, like, they're not breaking down the keratin of the hair to reduce all the contamination. Obviously, they got contamination. Or, like, it could have been a human hair. Like, they say contamination, but how many samples? Where were they collected? How are they collected? Who are they collected by? Where is the chain of custody? Where's the da-da-da-da-da? This is not a scientific study, and it's not coming out in a paper, and these things are not documented, and there's not even footnoted to where you can find that information. This is television, and guess what television's never going to do? Is give us the information that we want, proof positive of the Sasquatch, because that's going to publish in a scientific paper where all of that data is available, and then they're going to come back after that paper is out and do a documentary.
Right. I mean, it's going to be a matter of, if there's groundbreaking evidence upon us that's 100% irrefutable, it's a new species, it gets announced. Even if it's a little tiny insect in the Congo jungle underneath a rock that no one's ever seen before, it gets announced. They don't hold these type of groundbreaking announcements back, you know, 6 months, a year, you know, waiting for some documentary footage to freaking get edited to be put together.
You know what you don't do is you don't do promo for an earth-shaking, you know, like this would be the most mind-blowing discovery of our time. What you don't do is promo for that, because you keep it all very tightly closed until the study has gone through peer review and the paper is published, and then it comes out in a publication, which the publisher has rights to that, and then you do interviews and documentaries left and right for the rest of your life, and you're set.
That's exactly right.
What you don't do is this initial like hype. Because you don't want to know about it, because you don't want the leaks, and you don't want the poking, the prodding, and all that. So the problem with the Ketchum study from the beginning is that there was always the hype. We're not going to know about it. You know what we don't know about? We know about the discovery of, but we don't know about any of the study that's happened henceforth from the Red Deer Cave people. That was probably almost 5 years ago. They're still analyzing that stuff.
Yeah, and we won't hear anything about it until it's finished.
There's no hype, there's no conjecture, there's no anything. It's just, we just forget about it. I'm still waiting. It's coming soon. But that's because it's parked in my mind, not because they're promoting that something is going to, you know, the Red Deer Cave people are going to prove something. They're not done.
Right, it's going to be a little while yet.
The scientific study is going to play out. You're going to have this great discovery, and then you're going to forget about it because nobody says anything for 5 years.
Well, folks, as David said in the introduction tonight, we do have a giant announcement tonight. Finally, David and I have agreed to do it, and, well, let's just play the announcement for him, David.
The Squatchers Lounge Podcast, $1 billion big-ass fleer in space. Kickstarter coming soon.
That's right. If he can ask for $900,000 Canadian, why can't we ask for $1 billion to put a big-ass FLIR in space? Speaking of FLIR in space, the Seek Thermal should actually be sitting in the office. They locked it up and didn't send me a message until they just got off. So I won't have it until we talk about the year-in-review show. But, yeah, I do have the Seek Thermal, and it will be in my hot little hands tomorrow.
Very nice, but we'll need something bigger to put into space.
Yeah, unfortunately, that little sensor isn't going to do too good for more than, you know, 300 feet. So yeah, that might be a little bit tough. But
which is why we need $1 billion.
$1 billion. Well, here we go. Here we go on the topic tonight, there, buddy.
And now for tonight's topic.
That's right. Well, you know, we talk about it plenty of times, and we're going to get into it a little bit in depth here tonight. What exactly would Sasquatches be eating in the wintertime? Now, we talked about, do they starve all winter? You know, we kind of took that route on one of the podcasts before, but I'm starting to wonder in my mindset here. Now, if they're using the same areas over and over again, like, you know, large carnivores or omnivores would do, bears do the same thing, you know, would they not be smart enough, like a squirrel, to leave some provision stuff behind? Maybe they're collecting up, you know, nuts all fall long and dumping them in their in their winter sleeping grounds. What are your thoughts on that type of thing, David?
Well, nuts are somewhat storable, pretty much because of rodent teeth and the way that they can break into things. And it doesn't make a ton of sense for Sasquatch or something. Yeah, okay, Nutcracker Man, yada, yada, yada. Yeah, you think about that. Okay, the Paranthropus was probably more of a frugivore than a nutcracker. Anyway, but big jaws could probably break into a nice, ripe nut, get into the case and get into the meat.
You know, with the jawbones that we're talking about with the Sasquatch, you know, the Patty has those great big mandibles on the side of her friggin' head. You'd think she'd be able to crush through acorns like they were friggin' eggs.
But is she going to be able to break through on a regular basis without damaging the dentition, like hazelnuts and all these other things that are super hard, and once you dry those out, they become, you know, we're not talking about roasted, we're not talking about brittle things, we're talking about dried, almost petrified rocks with the casing like still on in some cases. Works for squirrels, you save the pine nuts, save, you know, all sorts of stuff. That's actually difficult for me to think that that's happening. However, Jeff, you and I have watched a bunch of documentaries about, you know, snow monkeys and this, that, and the other recently, and they all go back to kind of the same thing for that vegetative diet, is eating of bark and pine tips.
And insects and rodents and whatever they can get their little fingers on.
Insects during the summer are easy to find. They're the good, they're the big old grubs and whatnot. Once the freeze hits, though, the insects are they've either pupated. There's not a lot of larva left. There's not a, you know, so you're not digging for grubs per se. You're probably looking at everything's dead. So you got to move on to something else. Where do you get that protein? Now you're looking at roots. It doesn't make any sense to store roots.
Because like, they grow on their own all winter long.
Because they're down there right underneath the plant that's easily identifiable on the top of the ground. You could store and hide roots, but all it's going to do, again, is dehydrate them, dry them out, make them hard to chew.
And the roots that are available in the wintertime that are edible, you can actually smell through the snow. I've seen lots of animals root down in and you know, find large patches of, you know, 20 yards wide and 10 yards deep of something that has just been nosing through the snow and yanking the root pieces. You know, there's ginseng, there's all kind of roots that contain proteins and vitamins that these animals can smell, and it's got to be one of the things that they eat in the wintertime.
Oh, absolutely. Well, I'm pretty sure that they would eat something like that year-round, but in the wintertime it becomes increasingly important because that's, you know, like you mentioned ginseng. I'm thinking the thing of something that's like vitamin-rich, like I forget which vitamins are in it. It's like vitamin A or something. Yeah, whatever. But, you know, looking for all these different types of roots that you know are, you know, they don't know which vitamins are in them or what we happen to name those vitamins, but you crave those things. Like, you know, people talk about people lost at sea on a raft crave the eyeballs of fish because they have a good oil content. You know, you just want to eat these things. You smell them and you crave them because, you know, like, oh man, I have to have orange juice all of a sudden. Well, you're probably vitamin C deficient. But so there's a lot of these, you know, underground things, but I'm thinking, you know, the rodent thing, especially, you know, hibernating. And, you know, hibernating isn't there just to sleep down there. They're still rooting around. They're, like, underground. They're awake for part of the time. You can hear that and you can sense that. But getting into that snow and getting a rodent would be pretty easy because they can't excavate the snow like you can with these big hands.
You know? Right. Well, one of the things, too, you have to realize as well is not everything is snowed in. I mean, even though the area might be blanketed in a 10-foot cover of snow, there's still rock piles, there's still caverns, there's still caves, there's still rock falls that really are kind of barren still that the rodents will run around in that could really literally be like a lunchbox. You know, you kind of mark those little areas on your head to where the snow doesn't get in there to where the rodents will collect because they're mammals. They want to be warm. They don't want to be under the snow if they don't have to be. But, you know, I've seen the wood rats and stuff just occupy a coyote den, you know, knowing that the coyotes are going to eat them, but it doesn't matter because it's warm. And, I wonder if maybe they wouldn't seek out stuff like that too.
Absolutely. Well, and I have to apologize to everybody. I always think locally when I'm talking about this because that's what applies to me. And when, you know, where I live in Washington and up against the foothills here, anything, even now, like above like 1,200 feet, you're looking at potential snowpack. So that's where I'm thinking of, like, you know, even early winter, you're looking at snow. And then, you're absolutely right. There's all sorts of different places for creatures to be hiding, like proteins or and whatnot. We always talk about tracking. Tracking things is a lot easier in the snow. Fresh deer tracks and whatever. I think that there's a higher probability that Sasquatch would be eating deer in the winter than there is in the summer and the spring, you know, when all this.
I think you would be absolutely right. Kicking coyotes off of scavenging, you know, scavenging a coyote kill of deer. One of the other food sources that we see in the wintertime that people don't think about. Once you get below, you know, like the Nevada line in the mountains, you know, you don't really have a whole lot of snowfall like we were just talking about. Are the cattails in ponds? Cattails are full of stuff. I've actually witnessed in a 2-week period of time, literally 10,000 cattails disappear. Something pulled them out of the river, ate the bottom, or pulled them out of the pond, sides of the pond, ate the bottoms off of them, and left the carcasses laying there. Over a 2-week period of time, the entire side of the lake was just emptied of cattails. What does that?
That's a really interesting question. Yeah, unless you have an enclave of hippies living there, so, foragers.
Whatnot. Well, there was Rainbow Fest, but that was only a week, and you know.
Yeah. No. That's a really great starch. Like cattail roots and things like that. One of these days I'm going to go on this trek where I actually collect an entire dinner and come home and prepare it or whatnot. You know, we still have to cook our food or whatnot. But cattail roots is one of the things that I would be looking for in that later fall, early winter time.
And one of the other things that's available, especially during the wintertime, is birds. There are a lot of birds still around in the wintertime, even though there's snowpack everywhere. There's birds in the trees, man. I mean, not all birds migrate. Matter of fact, we can go turkey hunting here in January. So, I mean, there's those kind of birds that are still around as well. And turkeys are dumb, people. I mean, dumb. You sit there long enough, a turkey will walk up straight enough to you, you can grab him by the neck and wring it. I mean, I'm sure a Sasquatch at full speed is probably fast enough to run down and grab a turkey and kill it if it really wanted to. But there's a lot of bird activity that's still here through the wintertime as well, even in the snowpack areas.
Yeah, I think of the higher elevation, mountain grouse up here. I mean, that's one of the animals you can hunt with a rock.
Easily. Exactly. A rock or a stick. Just yep. Wait till you see one and whip it at it. You'll probably knock it out and there's dinner.
Yeah. Those type of food resources are obviously going to be available, but the ones that we don't think about a lot are those coniferous trees. There's a lot of vitamins and there's a lot of sugar in the sap. You know, it doesn't taste good to us, but like we were talking about earlier, if you're craving those vitamins and that sugar, that might taste amazing to you. That might be the best thing ever. You're compelled to chew on the side of a Douglas fir, you know, or something.
Well, I mean, you can pack on enough protein weight through the fall and everything to where as you're scavenging and scrounging for food for that 3-month miserable friggin' food shortage, that you can find enough to survive. But I don't think that's what these primates are doing. I think they're actually out there thriving, even in the wintertime. There's enough food sources for them.
Absolutely. Spring and summer, you're eating all, like, you know, spring, you're eating all the new growth and the shoots and like all that greenery, and like summer, there's so much, like everything's above ground. Let's just say that everything's above ground, and those roots, I think, while they might supplement, bears dig up roots, like. Like deer dig up roots. We dig up roots. There's no reason to believe that they wouldn't dig up roots, but that would be a huge dietary supplement in the wintertime versus in those other times when there's all that above ground food. And you could, like I say, you don't need to cache that food because it's there. You can see the tree that's or the bush that's growing above it or the starts that are growing above it and take out what you want from down below. It's there.
Yeah. Now, one of the stories I remember reading somewhere was a guy had caught an eyeball of a Sasquatch, and it had a rock on top of a hollowed-out stump, and it went over and it lifted up the rock and it reached down into the hollowed-out stump and it grabbed a mouse and put the rock back on it as though that was like Bigfoot's pantry. You know, he was breeding his own rats inside of that hollow stump rock. I don't really know how far I need to believe a story like that, but maybe so they put the rock there so it would stay warm so the wood racks would collect inside of there. Maybe that's the type of things that they're doing.
Farming? Cultivation? That breaches into that, you know. which is it's fine. I'm willing to be allowed to go there, but we're going to need more than one story to really go there. I've heard stories of the gifting stories of mice wrapped in grasses and leaves, like a little, like almost like an owl pellet, except for it's a fully non-digested mouse wrapped up. Like
left for a human?
Yes.
Oh, so it's reverse gifting. Okay.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you leave apples, they leave you dead mice wrapped up in these little, leaf and grass packages.
Right. I got to tell you, man, if I wake up in the morning and there's a grass-wrapped mouse outside of my, on the bottom of my hammock there, it's time to pack up and go home, brother.
See you later. So again, those are those sort of stories that take that out of the realm of just okay. Now we're past hunter gatherer, I guess would be a food store. I mean, you gather and you store. But yeah, that's something.
I wonder if they would have enough pre-thought, you know, to think, man, I'm gonna be hungry for these roots later on. Maybe I just take a couple of these and stash them in my beard. That way, later on, I can, you know, pick them out and start chewing at them like Cheetos.
You got some Cheetos in there? You want to share?
No Cheetos in the beard, man. The beard's looking glorious this year, boy. Wait till next year. I can't wait for that monster.
Epic.
That's right. Well, guys, we gotta tell you, we have had an incredible year here at the Squatchers Lounge Podcast. It has grown by leaps, and we've put on 2/3 more subscribers on our YouTube channel than we had when we started the year. I can't ask for anything more than that. We're pushing nearly 1 million views. All we can say, guys, is thank you very much for watching it. It's me and David and stuff we'd be doing anyhow, but we're going to at least promise to bring you what we believe to be the truth. And what's out here in Bigfoot, you can have an honest word from two guys who talk about it on a regular basis and at least have a firm clue in reality. What's your thoughts on it, David?
99% of the time, we might be wrong. But but this is what we do. I still love doing this. You know, I all the time, like I try to, like I'm more so just distancing myself from, you know, the forums and the Facebook pages and whatnot, but I still love doing this because this is my outlet. This is Jeff and I, and I'm glad that people enjoy watching it, and we do what we do because this is the conversation we'd be having if we weren't live.
That's right. I mean, it really is. But next year, we have already gone into some serious planning for season 3. If y'all like season 2, season 3 is going to blow your mind because we've really got some hot topics and some hot, interesting information coming up for you already. David and I sat down. What do you think, Dave? You ready to do season 3?
This is going to be a whole lot of fun. And it's one of those things. We do format changes, like, not just for, you know, for views and to come up with new topics, but it's something that, you know, I think that Jeff and I would have fun researching to come talk about. Whatever minimal research we do, like this time of year is really tough for me. I come in and I'm just like, all right, Jeff, you're leading. I'm just babbling. Go.
Yeah, it's not a problem, but next year's going to be a whole lot of fun, and we're going to actually learn something this year, next year. Absolutely. With that, I want to thank everybody for watching the Squatchers Lounge Podcast this year. For my co-host, the most amazing announcer man in Squatchers Lounge Podcast history, I am your host, the Reverend Jeff Kelly, and we will see you on New Year's Eve for the year in review. Thanks for watching. To may the Squatch be with you.
Hey, can't wait to
review. Dude, there's so many good things to talk about on that show, man.
I don't even know where to go.
Two live Bigfoot vocals from the Browns. I mean, that has to be getting in there somewhere.
Yeah.
You know,
Death Chowder. Death Chowder. We got to make
Death
a
Chowder. Oh, God.
Music in a bumper for Death Chowder.
Dude, this flu seat this week has almost reminded me of that, but it didn't last as long. Have a good night, everybody. Merry Christmas.